Good morning. How are you all? Good. I'm glad to hear that. It's good to see you this morning. If you're a guest with us, we're extremely grateful for your presence. Look forward to getting to know you better. When you came in, you should have been given a bulletin. And inside of that bulletin are upcoming announcements and activities that you'll want to be aware of. Take a minute, look through there, see what's going on. There's also an order of service for us this morning. And attached to that bulletin is a connection card. It is perforated. It tears off pretty easy. If you're a guest with us, we'd invite you to fill that out. Let us know you're here. And if you'd like some information about the church, you can also mark that on here. And you'll notice on the back, there is a place for prayer requests. If there's anything going on in your life or your family's life that we can be praying about, please share that with us and place this in the offering plate a little bit later in the service. We'll take those prayer requests, and this evening during our evening service, we'll pray specifically over each and every one of those. And so please, if there's anything we can be praying about that you know of, share that with us so that we can be encouraging and seek the Lord in those things. It has been a great week. It has been a busy week. And you're going to get a little taste of some of that here in a minute. But let me open us in a word of prayer, and then we're going to start our service off together. So let's pray together. Father God, as we come before you this morning, we are grateful for the opportunity of worship and thankful for the privilege that we have to be here. Lord, we pray that you would just guide and direct what happens here today, that it might honor and glorify you. Speak to us, encourage us, challenge us in our understanding of who you are and who you created us to be. And we just offer our praise and worship to you as an offering this day. May you be glorified through it. We ask all these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Right now, I'm going to invite all of our boys and girls to come on up here, if you would, please, because I need your help. So come right over in here. Nope, stand up, because we're going to lead everybody else. We're going to start off the way we start off every way we started off each day this week, but I need you guys to help us, okay? So come on over here. When we started off, what were the first things that we did each morning? Do you remember? We did the pledges. That's absolutely right. So we're going to invite everybody here to stand, and we're going to say our pledges. All right, we're going to begin with the pledge to the American flag. So everybody face the American flag, salute, and pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Now, you may not have done this before, but you're going to join with us this time. If you don't know the words, they will be on the screen. But we also pledge to the Christian flag, right? Mm-hmm. All right, so face our Christian flag. Salute and pledge. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands, one brotherhood uniting all nations in service and love. All right, and then we do one more pledge, and I need one of my helpers here. You want to come and help? No? You want to help? Well, turn around. You want to hold this? Okay, stand right here. Hold it up here high so everybody can see it. And we're going to pledge to the Bible. All right, ready, boys and girls? Salute and pledge. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word, and will make it a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path, and hide its words in my heart, that I may not sin against God. All right, good job. Boys and girls, I want you to line up right across the front row here, because right now we're going to sing the Star-Spangled Banner. So just line up right in front here. We're going to be standing, and Mike's going to lead us in singing, okay? Let's sing together. Come right over here.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's light?
I want you to come around up the stairs and right into that center spot of this stage right up here in the green carpet. She can come with you. Okay, come on down here. We're going to sing a song in just a minute, but I want to do something else right before we do that. So you can come on up. Come on. Okay, guys, go ahead and have a seat right here for just a minute. I want to show you what I've got. You guys get to be on stage for this part. You know what this is, don't you? This is an American flag. Now, I want to share just a couple things about this, but I need some help. So do not let this touch the ground, okay? Good job. Thank you very much. So I want to talk to you just a little bit about that flag. But to start with, I want to talk about the flag in general. Because a national flag, a lot of nations have flags. In fact, most nations will have a flag. And a national flag represents and symbolizes a country. This one represents the United States of America that you and I are part of. The national flag is flown by the government of a country, usually at all their government offices, but it can usually also be flown by citizens of the country. How many of you have flags at home maybe that get flown every now and then? You put a flag out for Flag Day or for 4th of July, okay? Sometimes we will do that. A national flag is designed with specific meaning for its colors and symbols. And the colors of the national flag are oftentimes worn by people of a nation to show their patriotism. And you can see that. We've got a lot of people sitting out here behind me wearing red and white and blue today, aren't they? You can see some of them. Some of them even have shirts that have flags on them. I'm wearing my red, and my tie is red, white, and blue to go along with it. And it shows our patriotism. Sometimes you'll find other symbols and colors that used from the flag in different things for our nation. Now, our flag, the United States flag, is a symbol of our nation. It represents the purpose and resolve of our nation, and it was first expressed by our founding fathers who founded a brand new nation. The flag represents the history and the future of our country. And so I want to tell you a couple things about this flag, and you may need to look over here because this one's folded up. You can't see everything. But what are the three colors of our flag? Red, white, and blue. Okay? So the colors that were chosen for the flag didn't have symbolic meaning in the flag because they already had symbolic meaning. The red, white, and blue was part of our seal, our coat of arms, if you will, for our nation that had already been developed. And so they took those colors and put them into the flag. Red means hardiness and valor, while white means purity and innocence. And the blue means vigilance, perseverance, and justice. Now, that blue section on the flag, it's called a canton. And when our flag was first created, it didn't have all those stars. Do you know how many stars it had when it first, the first time it was made? Anybody know that? 13 is absolutely right, because there were 13 states represented. Now, that's the only reason we have the 13 stripes as well, is because it represented the 13 original colonies that started out this nation. Okay? But what I found interesting is when they put those stars in that blue, they did that to represent a new constellation. Now, oftentimes we refer to a constellation as a setting of stars in the sky, like the Big Dipper. Have you seen the Big Dipper? That's a kind of a constellation. But it was a new constellation. In other words, a new nation had been formed. And that's what the stars on the blue were to represent. The stars themselves were to represent heaven, because it's often our goal as mankind to connect and have a relationship with God. And so that's represented on our flag. Now, I want you to look over here for a second, because we pledged allegiance to a Christian flag this morning too, didn't we? And in that Christian flag, we have the same colors. But you'll notice there is a red cross on the Christian flag up in that blue canton. The red is to represent the blood of Jesus shed for our sins. We talked about that this week at Vacation Bible School, didn't we? And then the blue on the Christian flag, the blue is to represent baptism, our obedience and testimony of what Jesus has done in our lives. And then the white is to represent the purity of Jesus, and the purity that when we ask Jesus to be our Lord and Savior, that becomes ours, that we're washed white as snow. And so that's the representation of that flag. Now, did you know that there are people who move to the United States and want to be citizens of our nation? And in order for them to be citizens, they have to take a test. They take classes and they study, but they have to take a test. And I'm going to ask you a couple of questions, and we're going to see if you know the answers. See if you can be citizens. No, you're citizens. If you were born here, you're born a citizen. But here's the first question. What do we show loyalty to when we say the Pledge of Allegiance? So I pledge allegiance to the flag. We said that a few minutes ago. But there are two things that we pledge allegiance to and show our loyalty to. Can you guess what those two things are? Say the Pledge of Allegiance in your head and think. No. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. So we're showing our loyalty to our flag and to the United States of America. All right. Why does the flag have 13 stripes? Okay, it shows the 13 colonies that originated our nation. Why does the flag have 50 stars? For the 50 states that we have in our nation right now. One star for each state. Okay, here's a hard one. What is the name of our national anthem? Banner. The Star Spangled Banner. And we sang that just a minute ago. Did you know that that was written on a British battleship out in the harbor right off of Fort McHenry? Fort McHenry was protecting some of our most valued soldiers, and the British were attacking. And there was a man standing on that ship all night long, waiting to see what would happen. All night long, that British ship was launching rockets and firing at Fort McHenry. At one point, early in the battle, in the evening, before the sun completely went down, the flag on Fort McHenry came down. They took it down. And when they were taking it down, the British thought that they had won, because any time a flag was lowered, it meant the people were surrendering. But before the British could celebrate too much, there was a bigger flag. It was a huge flag. In fact, it would take up most of the stage here. This was a huge flag that was put together, and it was raised over Fort McHenry, and that flag flew all night long. If you ever go to Washington, D.C., you go to the Smithsonian, in one of the museums, you can see that flag that flew over Fort McHenry. In the morning, a man by the name of Francis Scott Key wrote a poem that we just sang a minute ago. Those two verses that we sang, he wrote those from the ship that he was standing on. Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight for the ramparts we watch. He was wanting to know, can we still see the flag? And when that flag was still flying in the morning, after all that attack all night long, the British ship turned around and quit. And it represented our nation. That flag did. So that's why we stand for our flag. That's why we salute our flag. That's why we sing the national anthem. That's why we pledge to the flag. Now, we're going to talk about a couple other things about this flag here in a few minutes. But right now, I want you to do something for me. I want you to share a song with these guys that you learned this week. All right? So can you stand up? Our theme for this week, what was our theme?
In the
Wild. Can you guys sing that song for us? Can you do that? Your helpers are here. So let's do it. All right. They did a great job. Well done. You guys can go ahead and go back and have a seat while they're heading back to you, Mom and Dad and family, let me just share with you, it was a great week of Vacation Bible School. We had 117 that were registered, and the boys and girls had a great time. They learned a lot. They grew a lot. Decisions that were made, we had 11 boys and girls that prayed to receive Christ this week, and so we're pretty excited about that. In addition to 117 boys and girls that were registered, we had 78 workers that were here making that all happen. And so thank you very much, those of you who were working, thank you very much for your hard work and the impact that you've had on these boys and girls. Last thing I'd let you know is each day we took an offering, and that offering went for the Missouri Disaster Relief. We're helping the Missouri Disaster Relief with our offering this year. And the boys and girls this year brought in just short of $750 for that. So they did a great job. So we're very thankful for that and thankful for all the boys and girls and the what they learned and how they had a good time this week. So Mike, I'll turn it back over to you.
Let's stand together as we sing.
My country is a our Father.
last.
He is coming like the glory of the morning on the way. He is wisdom to the mighty, he is honor to the brave. So the world shall be his footstool, that the soul of wrong is slain. Our God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Father, we're so grateful for your presence with us here today, Father. We thank you for your love and your devotion and your watch care over us. We thank you for our country, Father. We thank you for blessing us in so many ways. We pray for the tithes and offerings that we're giving today, Father. May they be used to further your kingdom's work. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Amen. How do other people know who you are? How is your identity represented? There are really three ways a person's identity is understood. Three different ways that your identity is understood by other people. The first is by your name. My heritage involves a lot of that. Makes it hard for me to go back in my family tree very far. Coming from the Finland area, the way names were passed down was you would take the father's first name and add son to the end of it if you were his son, and if you were his daughter, you'd add daughter to the end of it. That's why if you look around in our society, you have a lot of sons. Isaacson. If I go back far enough, there was one of my forefathers was named Isaac. And his son was given a first name, but his last name was Isaacson. Johnson. Take your pick. You don't have as many daughters anymore. You don't have too many Isaac's daughters. It just doesn't flow very well for one thing, but the other thing is Isaac hoped that his daughter would get married and she'd take on a new name. And so the name of the daughters didn't pass on quite as much. But you know, when I was younger, my name would carry a little bit of identity with it. I was Willie Isaacson. And so in the community I grew up of Tumwater, Washington, that identified me as part of my dad's family, even my grandmother's family who was in the area. So our name gives us some identity, but in addition to that, it's also by our actions, how we live. You know, while my name will carry, and along with name comes title sometimes, and so, you know, I am known, there are people in the community here who know me as pastor, and some of you refer to me as pastor when you talk to me, and I'm fine with that. But our actions also give us an identity. How we live our lives, the things we choose to do or not to do, it gives an identity to us. It allows other people to see who we are. You see, that's one of the reasons I have encouraged us as a church family to live out our faith outwardly, publicly. Consider what you do and how you do it, because that communicates. It creates an identity. And the third way that your identity is understood is by symbolic representations. Now, individually, that oftentimes is material things. You know, there are certain people in our community, when their bright yellow car goes driving by, you know who that is. Or when the big truck goes driving by, you know whose it is. When you drive by a certain house, you know who lives there. Sometimes there are aspects of our lives that are symbolic representations. Even sometimes our jobs can be a symbolic representation of who we are. And that's how people look at us and identify us. That's how you look at other people and identify them. But these markers can also apply to a nation. Think about it for a minute. The United States of America. Now, if you truly understand what that name means, you will realize that it isn't about a centralized one leadership government. It is about a group of states that are united. In the name is the identity. And so, even a nation can be identified by its name. It can also be identified by its actions. The United States of America, in many parts of this world, is known for defending freedom and human rights. You know, we sometimes wonder, why do we have to get involved in what's going on in all these other nations? Why don't we just take care of ourselves? Well, I hope that's not you. Because if it is, it tells me a lot about your theology as a Christian. Because if that's you, then your theology as a Christian is, why do we worry about all those people outside of the church right now? They're not here, so why do we worry about them? Why do we need to even concern ourselves with them? We should take care of ourselves. Which we do take care of ourselves, and that's important. But God didn't make us to be a holy huddle hiding within the walls of a building. He called us to change the world. And so as a nation, if we truly believe in human rights, if we truly believe in freedom, then we help people find it, even when it's not on our shores. And so we have that identity. And then, of course, our flag. It's an identity. It's symbolic of who we are. If two ships meet out at sea, that is how you know whose ship it is. That symbolic identity. And it's an important aspect of who we are. So, how important is it in how we are identified in our lives? Does it really matter? I guess that depends upon who you are. I think of three individuals from the Old Testament out of the book of Daniel: Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Three individuals who were truly blessed while suffering as well. Three individuals who had been taken from their homes, transported to a different nation. As Babylon came in and took control, they exported people. These three individuals are taken captive. But of all the captives taken, they were elevated. They were put in positions of leadership in this nation. And yet they had a problem. When the king decided to listen to some of his advisors who wanted to get rid of these foreigners, when the king listened and put an edict, a law into place, that he would build a statue 90 feet tall, representative of him, and when the music would play, everyone would bow down to the statue. These three individuals chose not to. They got a quick identity. Everybody saw what was going on. They got the attention of a lot of people, and suddenly their identity was thrust into the open. And I want to read you this. Here's what the advisors to the king said. There are certain Jews. Immediately they identified them as Jews. Why? Because they wouldn't bow down to the statue. Why wouldn't they bow down? Because their God told them not to bow before any other gods or any other graven images. There are certain Jews whom you have appointed, their position, their job. These are some of the ones that you, king, have appointed to lead over us, that have been appointed over the administration of the province of Babylon. These men have disregarded you. That's what they said. You see, sometimes our identity puts us in a position that is very difficult. But that's not always a bad thing. They chose to stand. And their identity is forever linked to, well, it can be linked to a phrase that we hear in our nation from time to time. Stand for something or you'll fall for anything. You might say, well, what's the harm? They know that isn't a God. It's a graven image. They can just bow down and live. I mean, they knew the punishment. They were going to be cast into a fiery furnace. Is that really worth it? See, our mind and the enemy works within us to justify the things that create our own identity. To justify the idea that, well, if I just bow down, then I'll still be alive to be able to tell people about the one true God. Really? And what will you tell them? Oh, I believe in a God that, well, I really don't believe He can take care of me. I really don't believe He's worth standing for, but I believe in Him and you should too. That's really not what God's looking for. But that's also not who these three were. They said, O King, O great King, we will not bow. Even if you commit us to death, we will not bow. And our God is able to save us. We believe that. But even if He doesn't save us, we will not bow. That's a pretty strong faith. That gave them a pretty strong identity. I want you to open your Bibles, if you would, to Acts chapter 11, where the followers of Jesus gained an identity that many of us still claim today. See, here we will see that how we choose to live can often give us an identity with those around us. And it does. Whether you want to admit it or not, you are known by the people around you for how you choose to live, for who you choose to be. We're in Acts chapter 11 and we begin with verse 19, if you'll follow along. So then those who were scattered because of the persecution that occurred in connection with Stephen made their way to Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except to Jews alone. But there were some of them, men of Cyprus and Cyrene, who came to Antioch and began speaking to the Greeks also, preaching the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a large number who believed turned to the Lord. The news about them reached the ears of the church at Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas off to Antioch. Then when he arrived and witnessed the grace of God, he rejoiced and began to encourage them with all the resolute heart to remain true to the Lord, for he was a good man and full of the Holy Spirit and of faith. And considerable numbers were brought to the Lord. And he left for Tarsus to look for Saul. And when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. And for an entire year they met with the church and taught considerable numbers. And the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. They were first called Christians in Antioch. Now you'll notice two key items that resulted in the public identity of these people. There were two key items that caused them to be called Christians. The first is that they identified with Jesus the Christ. They publicly identified with Jesus the Christ. In other words, they heard the good news, the gospel story of what Jesus had done about His life, His death, His burial, and His resurrection. And they understood Him to be the Son of God. They believed that by faith. And they publicly pronounced it. They lived it. They identified it. But that's the second part, is they lived like Jesus the Christ. You see, as people were watching this group, they saw that how they chose to live was similar to the way that Jesus had lived when He had walked on the earth. Oh, by this time, the life of Jesus was told by many. Whether they believed or not, many, many people knew about Him, especially when the tomb ended up empty. Suddenly, He was thrust into the limelight of all of society. And now you've got these people outwardly identifying with Him, and then living like he did. It doesn't say how they used that term, Christian. It may have at one point initially been a derogatory term. But you know, today we wear that identity, I hope. I hope we own and wear that identity of the title of Christian, of the name Christian. Because we have identified with Jesus the Christ, and we are living like Him. So let me ask you that question. It's the second part that comes out of this verse that I think you need to consider. How do you identify yourselves? How do we identify ourselves? Here we sit today, getting ready to celebrate a national holiday, the 4th of July, when we declared our independence as a new nation, separate from England. As you get ready to celebrate that, as you sit here this morning in those pews in God's house, how do you identify yourself? I think there are two key things that we have gathered together here today, I hope, that are a part of your identity. The first is that you identify as Christians. Do you know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Have you received that gift that He gave? Do you own it? Do you identify with Jesus the Christ? And are you living it? The second way I hope that we identify ourselves as well is as citizens of the United States of America. Because this is where God has placed us. This is where we are. This is the nation in which we are citizens. I don't have time, but I do get a little frustrated. I do get a little passionate about this. In our own state, on the other side, right now, this weekend, just across the border, a city council voted 5-0 to remove the Pledge of Allegiance to the United States flag because it might offend someone. Let me ask you a question. Of all the nations across this globe, do you realize that the United States of America is probably the one that people are flocking to the most? Why do you think that is? Because it's a horrible place to be? Because they think it's a terrible place? No, they're coming because they see opportunity. They see freedom. They see ability to make something of themselves. You want to know if a country is a great country? See which way the doors are swinging. Here they're swinging in pretty heavily. And people are coming here because they want to be here. Do you think they come here and they're offended? If they're coming because they want to be here, why would you be offended? You know, I'm not going to move to a nation that I disagree with. If I have the opportunity to move anywhere on the globe, I'm not gonna move to a nation that I adamantly disagree with. I'm not gonna move to North Korea, where there is a dictatorship. One man controls everything. I don't want to be a part of that. I'm not gonna move there and then get upset. In fact, I'm not gonna visit places and be offended. If I go to a public event, Caleb is over in Europe right now. He's in Germany. If he got to go to Berlin yesterday, if he were in Berlin and he went to a public event and they invited everybody to stand for the national anthem of Germany, do you sit and rebel and say, "Well, I just don't agree with that"? No, you're visiting a country. You realize this is their country. You're not going to be offended by who they are, or you wouldn't be there. Citizens of the United States, you and I, you know, we recited three pledges this morning at the beginning of our service, and they were symbols of our identity to the U.S. flag as citizens of the United States of America, to the Christian flag, and to the Bible as Christians, as part of God's kingdom. Today in our society, teaching has been lost on how intertwined our identity as citizens of a free country and our identity as followers of Christ has been. It has been since the inception of this country up until the late 1960s. It was not a question that those two were intertwined and solidly linked together. But now we've been rethinking that. We've been rewriting history. We've been contemplating whether who we are is offensive or not. You know, there is a flag ceremony. Many of you are veterans. Many of you have had veterans in your family. There's a flag ceremony that takes place at military funerals, where the coffin is draped with an American flag. And then representatives of the United States military will take and lift that flag off the coffin, and they will fold it up and present it to the family in honor of the individual who served their country. It's a very meaningful service. But there's a part of it that most people don't recognize anymore. You see, that flag, when it is folded, as I showed you the boys and girls a minute ago, there are 13 folds in that flag. Exactly 13 folds in that flag. And each fold has a specific meaning to it. Did you know that? I want to share those very quickly with you. And here it is. The first fold of our flag is symbolic of life. The recognition that there are living things, and it is our life that we're talking about. The second fold is a symbol of our belief in eternal life. Let me repeat that. The American flag, the second fold of that flag in a flag folding ceremony, is symbolic of our belief in the eternal life. The third fold is made in honor and remembrance of the veteran departing our ranks who gave a portion of his life or her life for the defense of our country to obtain peace throughout the world. The fourth fold of the flag represents our weaker nature. For as American citizens trusting in God, it is to Him we turn in times of peace as well as in times of war for His divine guidance. We don't have time to go into that this morning, but I would encourage you, maybe get a book called The Bulletproof, George Washington, and see how many times a horse was shot out from underneath him during battle, or bullet holes went through his coat during the battle, yet God kept His hand upon that man and used him in amazing ways. The fifth fold is a tribute to our country. For in the words of Stephen Decatur, our country, in dealing with other countries, may she always be right, but it is still our country, right or wrong. The sixth fold is for where our hearts lie. It is with our heart that we pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. The sixth fold is where our hearts lie. The seventh fold is a tribute to our armed forces, for it is through the armed forces that we protect our country and our flag against all her enemies, whether they be found within or without the boundaries of our republic. The Army, the Navy, the Air Force, the Marines, the Coast Guard, who have protected this nation. The eighth fold of the flag is a tribute to the one who entered into the valley of the shadow of death, that we might see the light of day. It also is to honor Mother, for whom it flies on Mother's Day. The ninth fold of the flag is a tribute to womanhood, for it has been through their faith, their love, their loyalty and devotion, that the character of the men and women who have made this country great have been molded. The tenth fold is a tribute to Father, for he too has given his sons and daughters for the defense of our country since they were first born. The 11th fold, in the eyes of a Hebrew citizen, represents the lower portion of the seal of King David and King Solomon, and glorifies in their eyes the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The 12th fold, in the eyes of the Christian citizen, represents an emblem of eternity, and glorifies in their eyes God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. And the 13th fold of the flag, when the flag is completely folded, the stars are uppermost, reminding us of our national motto, "In God we trust." Military organizations used this script for the flag folding ceremony for years during military memorial services. We need to think about and encourage others to think about our statement of identity in our actions before we misunderstand what we are doing. Please hear this. How you live, the actions you take, communicate volumes. As a citizen of the United States of America, to pledge allegiance to that flag and to the republic for which it stands, to stand for the national anthem when the flag is there and the song is played, is not about a statement about whether you support the current person in the White House or not. It is a statement of a citizen of a nation. And so it is when you pledge allegiance to this flag as well. And so it is when you walk outside of this building and live your life daily for others to see. Folks, we're in dire straits. When we think we cannot own our own identity for fear of offending someone who doesn't agree with us. And I'm not just talking about that flag, I'm talking about that flag too. That is not who we are called to be. And these two are forever intertwined and directly linked. This nation was founded on the principles of this book. Have there been mistakes over the years? Absolutely. But folks, remember something. My Bible and your Bible both have the same passage in it. This says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." There is no one short of the Son of God who doesn't have a history of doing things that are wrong. There isn't a nation on the face of the earth that doesn't have a history of doing things that are wrong. We need to understand what our identity is going to be. Think about this. Who is it that's being blamed when one refuses to stand for the pledge or the national anthem? Who are you rebelling against when you do that? This is a nation of the people, by the people, and for the people. So they would actually be blaming themselves, would they not? To be honest, the reason that many choose to take this action is because they are a minority that cannot get their way. They cannot get what they want through the free election process that this nation has founded its government upon. And so they have to take extreme measures to try and stop and get what they want. They're like spoiled little kids. And that's not who we are to be. As followers of Christ, we are to stand for what is right and what is true. And sad to say, there are also many today who, through social media, have claimed the name of Christ and yet place all of their focus on attacking Christians who stand on the Word of God because it does not agree with what they want things to be. You know, you don't have to believe everything that's in here. That's your choice. God gave you that choice. But please do me a favor and encourage others to do the same. If you're not going to claim it and live it, then don't say that you're a Christian. I'm over it. I'm tired of the social media garbage. Of making a statement on what I believe is best for our country and being attacked by people who claim to be Christians and they want to misuse the Scripture to support their going against the Bible, or they're attacking me because doesn't the Bible say this? Doesn't the Bible say that you're to take care of everyone and love on everyone and take care of them and give them food and drink and water? Yes, it does say to help one another out. But it also says, if you're not going to work, then you don't eat. It also says we're to hold one another accountable. It also says that we're to help people see the light and quit living in darkness. And it frustrates me to no end as people misuse Scripture to attack in that way. They don't believe it, but they'll throw it in your face because you claim to believe it. And they'll throw it with their interpretation. It's time that you and I stand for what is right and hold fast to that which we identify ourselves as being. Christians first. Citizens also. And we need to stand for that. Let me just say it this way. Folks, own your name. Own your name. Own your actions and stand firm with the symbolic representations of your identity. Or choose a new identity. It's that simple. It really is. If you don't like the identity, then choose a different one and go get it. If you don't like what God says a Christian is to be, it's your free choice. You don't have to be one. It's the only answer I have found that gets me through life. But if you don't feel that way, then don't claim the name. And if you don't like the country, if you don't like the flag and what it stands for, you know, there are a plethora of nations that you could move to. Pick someplace else. I know it sounds harsh, but it's time we own our identity and own our actions and stand first. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Let's pray together. Father God, right now I just pray that you would give us wisdom and discernment in difficult times. Help us to see who you have called us to be. Help us to see who we have identified ourselves to be. And then let us be bold with that identity. Let us not be timid. Let us not hide. Let us not cower. But let us share the good news of our faith. Yes, it will offend some, but it's the only answer there is. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through Him. I am so thankful for many of the boys and girls who gave their lives to the Lord this week. But I also know there are others here this morning, some adults as well, who haven't yet done that. God, you are offering them the answer. You are offering them citizenship into the kingdom of God if they will accept it. And so I call upon your Spirit to move through this place and touch our hearts and minds and draw us into your presence. Help us to choose who we are going to be and where we are going to stand, and help us to be faithful to it. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. If you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, I'm going to encourage you to consider what it is that God wants to offer you and the identity that comes with it. For many of you, you know Him as Lord and Savior. Are you living it? You know, one of the first ways we live it is we proclaim it before a church family in baptism. We communicate to the whole church that we have asked Jesus to be our Lord and Savior. Have you done that? If not, I'd encourage you to consider it. We're also put in this community, and many of us have identified with this church in order to reach this community. If God has brought you to this church, if this is where you feel God has you, then you will you identify as part of the membership here to help us win this community? I don't know what God's saying to you right now. Maybe He's talking about putting these two things together of your Christian life and your citizenship and living that out a little stronger. Whatever He's saying to you this morning, I want to encourage you in this way. Do not sit and wait. If God is calling you, respond to Him now. And that's what this is, a time of invitation, a time for you to respond to what God is asking of you. The altar is open. Maybe you just need to come and pray. I will be here. A couple of our deacons will be here. Come and take action with whatever it is God is asking of you. Let's stand together as we sing, "You Step Out."
Oh, soul, are you weary?
hands. I'm going to invite you to take a seat. We're going to do one more activity of symbolic representation here in just a moment. But before I do that, I want to introduce you to somebody. Come on up here, Mr. Cade. This is Cade Best. And this week at Vacation Bible School, Cade came and prayed and asked Jesus to be his personal Lord and Savior. And this morning he comes wanting to be a part of this church family and follow in believer's baptism. So if you rejoice and celebrate with his decision, will you just give him a hearty amen?
Amen.
They're not quite as loud as we were at Vacation Bible School, are they? All right, we'll have him at the back along with mom and dad and his brother and sister. After the service, you'll want to come by and congratulate him and welcome him to the family. But right now, we're going to take time to celebrate the Lord's Supper together. So I'm going to invite you to go ahead and you can go back and have a seat with mom and dad. Our deacons, if you'll come forward, please, and prepare the Lord's Supper table. This is a time when we are celebrating in remembrance of all that Jesus has done for us, and it is a symbolic representation. As you will hear as we discuss it, this symbolic representation represents the blood and the body of Christ given for us so that we might have eternal life and we might have life abundant and full. And so